Hi everyone, Dr. J here, and in this video I want to talk briefly about a couple of issues related to what we actually measure when we're doing electrical resistivity tomography or really any resistivity method. And this is related to a couple of diagrams in the book. Let me see, figure 7.2 and 7.8, so you can check those out. So here we have our standard electrode configuration. We're taking a single measurement, and you know we have our flow lines like you see in the book. Now I want to talk about what we're actually measuring. So we have, as we said before, the observation point is approximately the center of this electrode array and approximately one half of the electrode spacing in depth. So a four node array like this is going to give us a measurement point that's something like right there. Now this is not necessarily, so this is obviously not where the electricity is going, or the only place where the electricity is measuring, because you can see we've got all these lines of current flow. What that is something, it represents something about the average measurement location over a volume which is sampled by the electric current. So if we can draw a box, kind of, it would look something like this. And this is an approximation, and it will depend on the subsurface properties. But for some penetration depth, the sampling volume for this array is going to be something like this. And there's going to be less penetration of current to depth, more penetration at shallow depth. There's just more lines, as you can see, at shallower depths. So this point here is some representative of that average, of that volume average, we should say. Now let's extend this to the 2D electrical resistivity tomography method, ERT. So if we look at the ERT electrode array, you know, we've got a whole bunch of electrodes in a line, and we're taking sample points, as we said before, at various intervals. Something like this would be our sampling locations. It's important to realize that these points are, again, the volume averages of the measurements that are made at each set of four electrodes. Depending on which set of four electrodes we're using, it'll be one of these points, but each point is a volume averaged measurement. And what you have to realize is that we're actually sampling the entire volume. So this point is an average measurement of that whole volume, and it's not correct to say that it's just a simple average, because you're averaging it depending on the density of current flow, and so some areas will have more weight in that average, but it is an average over that whole volume. And so what we have to do, and this is also why when we talk about in the book, it talks about a pseudo section, and this is apparent resistivity because it's sampling all these things. And if it's a homogeneous medium, then it will be true resistivity, but obviously in the earth we never have a homogeneous medium. There's always going to be some type of heterogeneity or anisotropy or both. And so these are apparent resistivities, and we have to actually solve for what the true resistivity structure is that gave rise to this apparent resistivity structure. I'll just draw one of these electric current lines between a set of four electrodes. So for this X here, where it's taking not just that point, a measurement at that point, it's some volume average of, you know, approximately that part of the subsurface. And it, again, it's going to depend on what the resistivity is, what that shape actually is. But okay, so now let's say we have some layering here, and this drawing is going to start looking a little complicated, but let's just go with it. And let me see, I guess I'll use black. Black represents the subsurface geology. So let's say we have some soil up at the topmost layer. Okay, so there's a soil horizon. And then now let's say right here on the edge of this horizon, there's this kind of alluvium. Maybe it's a dip in the bedrock. Maybe this is a karst region. And that dip is filled in with alluvium. Or soil. Let's call it soil. So we have soil up at the top. And I'm really making a mess of this drawing now. But anyway, soil up at the top. And then here's this dip. And then maybe further down, or maybe over here, let's say, we have a slight offset. And there's a fault. And here's a couple different bedrock layers. And so now we're starting to get a little bit more realistic, okay? So now we have row one for soil, row two for this topmost layer of bedrock. We have row three and row four even. Okay, now obviously we're not sampling row four with this particular electrode spacing. What you can see is that the red ray pass, the volume in that green box that we're sampling, it includes the alluvium at the top, but also includes a little bit of this anomaly here where we have this filled in region that's maybe it's a karst region or whatever, and it's filled with soil. So we're sampling that a little bit at this point, even though this point, you know, this point is not in the alluvium, the total integrated area is. We're also sampling here, not just row two, but a little bit of row three. And so we're actually sampling row three, even though here we're not really near row three. What this means is that we can't just use the pseudosection. The pseudosection is going to give us, as I said, apparent resistivity, and as it says in the book. But if you were to create your geology based just on that pseudosection and say, oh, well, this is the low anomaly, or the low resistivity anomaly is here, you may or may not actually match the surface observations if you were to back those out. And that's because, as you can see, this type of layering is going to result in a particular resistivity profile, and that profile is going to be affected at this point, for example. It's going to be affected by all these different layers. So even though that point is only in layer 2, or row 2, even though that point should only be sensitive to the resistivity in layer 2, it's actually going to be sensitive to what's around it. And it's going to depend on what the spatial volume is of that's being sampled, right? So this is essentially the very shallowest point that you could get, the very smallest volume or the highest resolution. Imagine now if you take the outermost electrodes. They're going to be sampling a volume. Looks probably something like that. So that volume is going to be getting an average of all of this stuff. And at that point in time, you know, this is getting to be a four-layer problem with an offset, and this is actually a more realistic situation that we find, but it's also going to be harder to interpret unless you have outside geological information that tells you, oh, there's a fault here, or, oh, there's an alluvial. I mean, so this here is going to be fairly easy to see. If you extend your profile this way, you should be able to find that anomaly. Whether or not you can find the fault in all these four layers and uniquely separate out all those signals is going to be a little bit challenging. You're going to have to do some interpretive work, and you're going to probably need some outside information to validate your results. So this is the important thing. How these layers are set up, this is just the geometry aspect of it. How this geometry is set up in relation to your nodal array is going to determine what your results look like. And it's, again, important to realize that you're getting kind of volume integrated measurements. And so, you know, as the array becomes much longer, this penetration becomes much deeper, and the average volume measurement is going to look much more like your row four. As it is right now, we really haven't even sampled row four that well, even though the point, well, here I've drawn a point in row three, maybe it's in row three, maybe it's getting a little bit into row four, the row four layer. Either way, we're not going to have a true measurement of what row four is because it's got this integrated nature to the measurements. So this is the thing that one of the things I wanted to point out in this video, which is that the resistivity that we measure is an integrated measurement. We're measuring the integrated current flow between two electrodes as it's going through this volume. So that's one thing that's important to keep in mind. We're not getting point measurements. The other thing is that the measurements that you make are going to be dominated by the most conductive material. So let's say that we have this fault here, and let's say that along the fault there is fluid, and I guess I'll use blue for fluid. This makes sense, right? So fluid flows along a fault because a fault slips. The fault is often conductive. A fault can be conductive, or it can be, what's often the case is that the fault core is resistive to fluid flow. It's impermeable. But just outside the fault core, there's this damage zone, which is parallel to the fault zone, and that's actually quite permeable. Either way, it doesn't matter. Let's just say that this fault is allowing fluid to flow up it for whatever reason, and so you have this very high conductivity and low resistivity area in this measurement. Okay, so now what's going to happen? Well, your measurements are going to be strongly impacted by this conductive layer. So for example, if we're starting over here, or even better yet, if we're starting one or two nodes away, if we add a couple of electrodes on the end here, and we're sampling really deep, you can see what's going to happen as electrical current intersects and interacts with this conductive layer. It might travel along that layer and then travel back up to another electrode. So the signal that you're going to see is going to be really dominated by these conductive materials. This is going to also be true with layering. So let's look at a little bit of a simpler case. So let's just say that you have a three-layer case, row one, row two, row three, and that row two, layer two, is very thin. If row two is very resistive, if it's strongly resistive such that row two is greater than row one and row three, it's going to be very, very hard to see this small layer, right? Because the more conductive layers are controlling the current flow, and this layer is small, it's not big, and so you're not going to be able to see that very well on the resistivity profile or ERT section, whatever you're looking at. On the other hand, if that's a very conductive profile, or sorry, conductive layer, row 2 is much greater than, row 2 is resistivity, so let's say it's conductivity, row 2 is much, much less than row 1 or row 3. Well, in this case, you might have trouble actually imaging row 3 because it's more resistive. Most of the current is going to go through row 2, and that's actually going to act as a lower floor on your measurements. And so in this case, you're not going to have good depth penetration. So these are just some important things to keep in mind. Your measurements are going to be dominated by your most conductive material, and the measurements that you get are not point measurements. They're integrated measurements, integrated over a volume. So keep that in mind while you're doing your interpretation, while you're doing your analysis of our resistivity, our ERT pseudosections, and that'll help you a lot when it comes to interpretation. All right, with that, I will say goodbye and see you in the next video.